Amen. So moving our way through the book of 2 Samuel chapter 4 tonight, and we see here in this chapter is that there's basically two different leaders. We see Ish-bosheth and David. And I think both of these guys had some attributes, you know, one that we can, take heed to as, you know, something we don't want to be. You know, they both had attributes, good and bad, respectively. Of course, Ish-bosheth was the guy who had the, you know, the negative attributes that we don't want to adopt. Whereas David, he has these other attributes that we should look at. At least a few of them are seen here. Of course, there's others we could talk about, but that there are things in David that we should want to adopt, or at least understand about leadership. And, Ish-bosheth is an example of somebody who was a very weak leader. And it says there in verse 1, and when Saul's son heard that Abner was dead in Hebron, his hands were feeble and all the Israelites were troubled. So, of course, we know that Ish-bosheth was installed by Abner. You know, Abner was kind of the one who made him what he was. He's the one that took him and set him up as king. So when Abner died, and, you know, our last chapter, chapter 3, you know, Ish-bosheth's kind of out, you know, shown for what he is. You know, he's just this figurehead. He really doesn't have any power. In fact, you know, he doesn't even have much respect because even his own captains come and kill him. And they had their own motives and things like that. But, you know, what it shows us is that Ish-bosheth was a very weak leader. He wasn't somebody, he wasn't a take charge kind of guy, and I don't think he was very well respected. I mean, if you remember last week, Abner just told him off right to his face, and he could answer nothing. You know, he was a very weak leader. And, you know, it's important if we're in leadership, and by the way, we all are, you know, even down to children. You know, if you have younger siblings, you are a leader, okay? But, of course, you know, this pertain more to people who are in leadership positions that have a broader influence, you know, fathers, husbands, you know, church leadership, maybe at the job, things like that. If you're in leadership, you know, you have an effect on people. You are going to have an effect on people for better or for worse. I mean, that's what it says there in verse 1. And when Saul's sons heard that Abner was dead in Hebron, his hands were feeble, right, showing his own weakness. But notice, and all the Israelites were troubled too. It wasn't like all the Israelites like, well, all Abner's dead, but don't worry, Ish-bosheth's got this. You know, he's going to take over. He's going to step in. He's going to fill the role. They said, what, Abner's dead? What are we going to do? You know, it just shows you that this guy, Ish-bosheth, was just a weak leader. And it affected all Israel, it says there. They all were troubled. And of course, what they were troubled about is what was going to happen. They didn't know what David was going to do. And David's reputation is kind of misunderstood. You know, I think they were all kind of assuming. We see it here, you know, later in the chapter with Mephibosheth's nurse, you know, fleeing from David. You know, why is my question. You know, why are you fleeing from David? He's been nothing but merciful. I mean, he was merciful with Saul all the times he could have killed him. You know, he wasn't on, you know, the war path. He wasn't out for blood. But, you know, Israel is troubled by the fact that they no longer have a strong leader in Abner. And, of course, you know, they might not, fully understand what David was going to do. What was his reaction going to be? So it affected Israel and it affected his men. It affected the people that were directly under him. You know, Ish-bosheth's, the men that he commanded, they had no respect for him. And once his, you know, that power that he had was taken away, you know, that really came shining through. They showed their true colors. You know, once the real power in Abner was gone, that's who they really feared. It's kind of like, you know, that cartoon or that movie or that, you know, you've all seen the illustration where, you know, you have the little bear who's growling at the mountain lion and scares him off and he thinks he's big and bad. And he turns around and it's actually the mountain lion was afraid of the big bear that was behind him, if you get the illustration. He, that's what it was with Ish-bosheth. He's that little bear, and once the big bear's gone, you know, the mountain lion's like, well, it's dinner time, right? And that's what these guys go on, what happens here. It says in verse 2, and Saul's son had two men that were captains of bands. The name of the one was Baanah, and the name of the other, Rechab. The sons of Rimmon, a Beerothite of the children of Benjamin, jumped down to verse 5, and the sons of Rimmon, the Beerothite, Rechab, and Baanah went and came about the heat of the day to the house of Ish-bosheth, who lay on a bed at noon, and they came thither into the midst of the house as though they would have fetched wheat, and they smote him under the fifth rib. Now, I don't know what it is about that fifth rib business. It's like everyone's getting it under the fifth rib. So I guess that's just like a good soft spot, you know, to get somebody. I've never counted far. I want to do it right now. Like, how far down is the fifth rib? Is that the last rib? I don't know. I'm not that much into anatomy, but, you know, that's where they got him, under the fifth rib. Maybe that's some vital spot they all knew about. And Rechab and Baanah, his brother, escaped. For when they came to the house, he lay on his bed in his bedchamber, and they smote him and slew him and beheaded him and took his head and gat them away through the plain all night. So, you know, the fact that he was a weak leader led to his downfall. These guys had no respect for him. They weren't afraid of him. Once the real power was gone, they saw that, again, like we talked about on Sunday morning, that vacuum was created, because leadership always leaves a vacuum. It does not leave a void, and somebody wants to step in and fill it. And these guys, you know, that's kind of what they're trying to do. And they're trying to get on David's good side. We'll see that here in a minute. But what we see at the beginning of this chapter is how weak Ish-bosheth really was as a leader. He's not respected, and not by his men, not by the nation. So what is it that made him weak? Look, if we don't want to be weak leaders, we want to be strong leaders, we should look at Ish-bosheth and say, well, what should I avoid? What attributes should I not adopt? What are things that I should look out for in my own life so that I don't end up like an Ish-bosheth? Maybe not, you know, getting smote under the fifth rib and beheaded, but at least, you know, still having the respect of other people, you know, that you are to be leading. Well, I think one of the first things we can see is that he was afraid of man. I mean, that's really what's going on here. When he finds out that Abner was dead, his hands were feeble. And why was that? Because now he's afraid of what David might do. He's afraid of what's going to happen. It's a fear of man. Go over to Proverbs. We're going to be in Proverbs for a minute here, so you might want to keep something there. Proverbs chapter 29. You know, and fear is probably one of the most debilitating things for people. You know, fear just cripples people. And fear is not something that we can have, especially, you know, none of us should have it. You know, there's nothing to be afraid of except for the Lord, okay? But, you know, it's especially important to not be a fearful person when you're in a position of leadership. It's especially important to not be a fearful person when you're behind a pulpit. You know, you can't be afraid to preach the whole counsel of the Word of God. You know, and that's what's going on today. You wonder, why is it that our country has gotten to the place that it is? Is it just because Hollywood has just gotten so wicked, the music industry is just so wicked? Or is it because men behind pulpits have gotten afraid of preaching the whole counsel of God and begun to back down? That's what's going on. You know, if the world is the one that should be afraid, you know, if the men of God would stand up and preach the whole counsel of God, you know, they'd preach the queers back in the closet. They'd preach the ungodliness back out of the movie theaters. They'd preach the ungodliness back, you know, into the stereo box or whatever. They would preach against these things. These things would creep back into the darkness. Okay, if we flipped on that light switch called God's Word, you know, all the cockroaches of this world would scurry. But what's happening is that men who are in leadership, you know, in pulpits in this country, are afraid of what might happen. And, you know, and it's not that it's unwarranted. I mean, it's unwarranted in that it's irrational, right? But you can understand, what is it that they're afraid of? It's man that they're afraid of. They're afraid if they get up and they preach something controversial out of the Word of God, that, you know, they're going to end up on the 11 o'clock news, that someone's going to come knock on their door and want to interview them. Would that happen? Yeah. They might even throw a bomb in your church these days. You know, or it might just be they don't want it. Maybe it's not even something controversial. Maybe it's just something that the Bible teaches. Maybe it's just some standard. Maybe it's just some, you know, doctrine that's going to make people upset. And the man of God gets up, and he knows he's supposed to preach it, but he won't preach it because it might upset somebody in the church. You know, they're more worried about the offering. They're more worried about the plate getting full than they are actually preaching God's word. And, you know, the irony is that most people want hard preaching. Most people want to come to church and have their faces ripped off. You know, it's kind of hard to understand. We can't wrap our heads around it all the time. But you know what? Hard preaching works. That's what amazes me every time I get up and say, well, it's probably going to upset somebody. And then somebody says, oh, that's exactly what I needed. And people get right. People make changes. You know, and that's why it's important that, you know, if we're especially in the pulpit of all places, that we should not be weak. We should not be fearful of man. We should not be afraid to preach the whole counsel of God. Bible says for 2 Timothy, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner. You know, we shouldn't be afraid, or we shouldn't be ashamed of the gospel. We shouldn't be ashamed of God's people. We shouldn't be ashamed of God's man, his word, none of it. There's nothing in here to be ashamed of, folks. You know, we should love every word that's in this book. There should be nothing in this book that makes us say, well, you know, I wouldn't want anybody to know I actually believe that. You know, if someone said, well, do you believe what the Bible says? Yeah, every line, every page, every word, every jot, every tittle, I believe it, because it's God's word. We should not be afraid of it. He said he's not given us a spirit of fear, but that we should, what, be thou the partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God. You know, if me preaching the word of God, it brings persecution to this church, you know, we should be willing to partake of that affliction. You know, and the Bible actually says that that's something to rejoice over. You know, that we should rejoice when men persecute us. That we should leap for joy. You're there in Proverbs chapter 29. Look at verse 25. Why is it so important that leaders do not be weak, that they are not afraid of man? Because the fear of man, it says here in Proverbs 29, verse 25, the fear of man bringeth a snare, but whoso putteth his trust in the Lord shall be safe. So what is it about the fear of man? What is it? It brings a snare. And what's a snare? You know, it's something that, it's a trap, basically. You know, a snare is like, you know, you'd hang a string or a loop or something that would snare an animal. And it doesn't necessarily kill them, you know, immediately. It just restricts their movement, doesn't it? It keeps them from going where they'd want to go and doing what they want to do. It keeps them in one spot. And, you know, that's what the fear of man does to a person. You know, it constricts them. It keeps them from saying everything that needs to be said. It keeps them from doing everything that needs to be done. It's a snare. That's what the fear of man brings. You know, and that's what you see in Ishbosheth, a guy who was snared by the fear of man. You know, he wasn't able to, you know, to be the type of leader that he needed to be. What if Ishbosheth, you know, just, you know, turned it on at some point? I mean, he could have been a strong leader if he wanted to. Now, ultimately, the kingdom was going to be taken away from him, but he still could have been, you know, somebody of use rather than just this weak, feeble person if he had stood up for himself. And what is it? What made him such a weak leader? Well, it was his fear of man, for one. But also, I believe it was his laziness. I think there's a picture of laziness here. And some people might argue about this and say, well, you know, because it says in verse 5, let's read it there before I get into this. His laziness is what made him a weak leader. And the sons of Rimmon, the Beerothite, Rechab, and Baanah went and came about the heat of the day to the house of Ishbosheth, who lay on a bed at noon. So you'd read that and say, well, what are you doing on a bed at noon? You know, that's usually not a good sign, you know. I don't care who you are. You know, are you sick? He doesn't say he was sick. He doesn't say he had some kind of an ailment. He's just laying in his bed at noon. Now, some people might say, well, it was the heat of the day. Maybe back then that's something that they did. But, you know, from the context here, that's not what's going on with Rechab and Baanah. It seems like they were kind of working, or at least appeared to be working. They're coming in to get wheat. You know, and even if you're, you know, taking some time off to get out of the heat of the day, do you necessarily have to lay down in a bed at noon? You know, it doesn't say he came in and it's like they found him there. Like he was already in there. He's already in the bed at noon. Like, oh, you know, here he is. So they come and they find him here laying on this bed at noon, right? And some people might argue and say that's not what's going on. To me, that's what it looks like. I mean, if you're laying in a bed at noon, you're probably kind of a lazy guy, right? You'd think this guy would be scrambling. You think this guy would just be trying to make some moves here. You know, Abner's dead. Who knows what David's going to do? Israel's troubled. What's he do? He goes and takes a nap? I mean, I don't care how hot it is. You got to get something done. Sometimes, you know, no matter how difficult it is, there's a job that needs to be done, and you got to go do it. And this guy, you know, he literally loses his head because of how lazy he is, because he doesn't want to get up and get something done. So I believe this is another thing that made Ishbosheth a weak leader. That was his laziness. You know, you're in Proverbs, go to chapter 20, Proverbs chapter 20. And the Bible talks a lot about laziness in Proverbs. It says in Proverbs chapter 10, verse 5, he that gathereth in summer is a wise son, but he that sleepeth in harvest is a son that causeth shame. You know, those are hot parts of the year, aren't they? Summer. Well, we know something about that around here. You know, he that gathereth in summer is a wise son. You know, the person who's not going to let the heat, you know, drive them back into the house at noon to take a nap. But the person is going to go out and work anyway because there's a job to be done. Because you can't gather in the winter because it's winter. Things aren't growing. The harvest doesn't come in then. That's not when you're supposed to be doing work. You're supposed to be doing work during the summer. You got to make hay while the sun's shining, as they say, right? That's, you know, there's an appointed time. There's an appointed season when this work must be done. You know, in this analogy here, it's summertime. And it's the wise son that's a hard worker. That's what makes him wise. That's what makes him a good leader. The one who's willing to go out and do the hard work, you know, even when it's uncomfortable, when things are difficult. We can't be the type of people who just want to only work when it's easy. We only want to do things when it's easy. You know, and we could apply this in so many areas in our life. You know, think about, you know, all the spiritual disciplines that we have to take on as Christians. You think about prayer, okay? That, you know, praying, you know, you would think that's easy, right? But sometimes I think that's like the the biggest struggle for a lot of people is to just pray. You know, what about Bible reading? That's another big one, right? Because we would think, oh, we always love reading the Bible. You know, we hope that's the case. But if we're honest, you know, we're still in the flesh. And there's some days where you're like, oh, I got to read my Bible today. And I'm in some book that I'm not a big fan of, or it's going to be a heavy reading, right? There's some days you had to get it done. You know, if you're only going to read your Bible when it's exciting and fresh and new and easy, when you're just thrilled to read it, you know, and we all have these ebbs and flows in our Christian life. We have the mountaintops and the valleys that we all go through spiritually. But if you're only going to read, if you're only going to be disciplined, you're only going to do that which is difficult when it's easy, you know, then it's just not going to get done. Then you know what? You're going to be like an Ish-bosheth. When it gets hot, you're just going to go inside and lay down, take a nap, and then something really bad is going to happen, you know, spiritually speaking. What about church attendance? You know, it's easy to go to church when it's convenient. It's easy to go to church when, you know, it's not costing anything. You know, it's easy to go to church when, you know, it's always exciting when it's just, you know, it's the guest preacher that's there bringing that hot message, you know. But what about when it's this guy, you know, and it's 2 Samuel chapter 4. We're going through the book of Deuteronomy. We're in Leviticus. You know, what if it's some chapter or some subject that maybe you're just not that enthralled about? You know, but I know it's hard. It's difficult. But you know what? It doesn't make it, it doesn't give you an excuse to not do these things. Okay. That was his problem, his laziness. You know, what about the soul winning? You know, let's get on that for a minute, too. You know, that's an important thing to bring up, especially this time of year. We go out and we gather in the summer, don't we? We're going out trying to bring in the sheaves in the summer. We're going to go out and plant spiritually and sow spiritually and try to bring in a harvest. You know, that gets harder to do in the summertime, doesn't it, when it's 115 or whatever degrees. And look, you know, here's the thing about the Christian life. It's measured in decades. It's not measured in years. And if we're going to be people that make it through for the long haul, you know, we have to stick out through the summers. We have to go through the hard times, right? And I'm not saying it's not okay to slow down. That's a wise thing to do. You know, sometimes in the Christian life, all we need to do is just, rather than just stopping completely, just quitting completely, it's better to just maybe pull back for a while. You know, gather ourselves, catch our breath, and then move forward. You know, it's kind of like that hike we went on to Mount Lemmon. You know, I'm going to have illustrations from that thing for weeks. I'm so glad I went, right? I'm glad I did something hard because now it's paying off. You know, I know some of you probably might have run up that hill, but I certainly didn't. I think brother, you know, Robert, he was running up and down a couple times, right? This guy wasn't running. There was no running taking place. You know, But I was determined to get there. It wasn't easy. But you know what? Sometimes I had to stop, sit down, catch my breath, have some water, eat something, and then get up and go a little further and then stop. You know, it wasn't just this dead sprint, this just flat-out race up the hill to see how fast I could get up there. I wanted to get there, but I knew it was hard, so I had to pace myself. It's the same way in the Christian life. Look, the soul winning is going to get a lot hotter and harder to do in the summer, isn't it? Maybe this isn't the time of year to go out 3 hours every week. You know, maybe this isn't the time to go to the Sunday, you know, three-hour, four-hour-long soul winning session. Maybe it's time to go to the Saturday one-hour session. Maybe it's time to go to the Thursday 45-minute session, you know, or maybe it's just time to get, you know, with somebody and go on your own time. I don't know. But here's what you don't want to do. Go inside at the heat of the day and take a nap and lay down. Because that's when bad things happen, you know, and we're gonna lose ourselves spiritually. You're there in Proverbs chapter 20, verse 4. The sluggard will not plow by reason of the cold. Doesn't really go with our story, but it's the same principle. It's the weather that's keeping this guy in, right? He's the sluggard. He will not plow by reason of the cold. Therefore, he shall beg and harvest and have nothing. You know, there's consequences for being a lazy person. If we're a lazy person spiritually, or maybe even in our jobs, you know, we're not going to advance. We're not going to grow. You know, there are consequences because the harvest is going to come. You know, we want to apply this again. Go back to the soul winning. You know, there is going to be a harvest, isn't there? There's going to be a day when we, you know, return our talents to the Lord. There's going to be a day when we give an account to God. And hopefully on that day, we're not going to find ourselves begging. Oh, can I have some of your sheaves to present? It's like, no, you had your chance when it was cold out during the harvest. You had your chance to go out when it was hot. And you know, you could have got one if you wanted one, right? And here's really kind of what I think is going on with Ish-bosheth, even a little bit more than just his laziness. I mean, he's definitely, you know, if you say, well, maybe he's not being lazy. Okay, but it does look like he's kind of hiding from his problems, doesn't it? I mean, he's in his bed. He's laying it down at noon when the kingdom's, you know, everything's just, it's just big toss up. Abner's dead. Who knows what's going to happen next? And he's laying down, going to sleep. You know, if you, the other application would be this, is that you can't hide from your problems. You can't just hide from your problems. And I think sometimes people do that, especially today. I mean, they hide, you know, I'm not saying that, you know, they go climb in a closet somewhere. Or they have a lot of different ways of hiding today, don't they? People hide from their problems through drugs, alcohol, you know, pharmaceuticals, you know, all kinds of different things. People want to just deny the fact that they have an issue, deny they have a problem. They try to run and hide from these things, don't they? But your problems always seem to find you, don't they? They're always there waiting for you. They'll come find you where you are. That's what happened to Ishbosheth. You know, he's trying to hide from this whole situation, and it literally came right to his bed and took his head off. So these are some of the attributes of Ishbosheth that we as leaders do not want to emulate. We do not want to adopt these characteristics. And we should actually be on the lookout and making sure that we're not like this. You know, if we have, you know, because we could really pick on Ishbosheth, but you know what? These are all, you know, there's no such, you know, temptation as taking him, but such as common to man. These are things that we could all, to some degree, be guilty of. You know, the fear of man, laziness. What about a lack of vigilance, right? A lack of vigilance. If you're going to be a leader, you have to be somebody who's vigilant. You have to be on the lookout. You know, that, and especially men in the homes, you know, men, husbands, fathers, you know, we have to be on the lookout in our homes for sin creeping in. You know, from our families going astray. We you know, that responsibility is on us. Of course, wives and mothers, they have that responsibility too. They share in that responsibility for the children. But you know, that really falls upon the men. You know, it goes same for here in the church. You know, that's why one of the qualifications for the bishop, you know, the elder, the preacher, even a deacon, is that they have to be vigilant, right? A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given hospitality, apt to teach, right? He has to be vigilant. What does that mean? It means he's alert, he's awake, he's not just asleep at the wheel. You know, that's a really important attribute to have as a leader. You know, in the church house, you know, what, I have to be vigilant that the false doctrine doesn't creep in, you know, that the disunity doesn't try to creep in. You know, and be on guard for these things. Because why? Because we have an adversary, right? Who walketh about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. That's why he says, what? Be sober, you know, be serious, take it seriously, and be vigilant. You know, be alert. Be vigilant, be alert, be awake to what's going on in this world spiritually. I mean, that word vigilant, you know, you think about the word vigil, right? What does that mean to keep a vigil? You know, you stay up, the candlelight vigil, they light the light so they can illuminate things, they stay up. You know, they're staying awake. That's what it means to be vigilant. Don't be like this guy, Ishbosheth. When problems were happening, things were going on, you know, if anyone should have been vigilant in the story, it's this guy. I mean, even if he wasn't trying to, you know, prove himself as a leader, he should have at least been vigilant about the fact that maybe someone was going to try and take advantage of the situation. Maybe if he'd been a little bit more vigilant, and when, you know, these two guys walked in, you know, the Rechab and, you know, the sons of Rimmon, maybe if they walked into a 12-gauge in their face, you know, things would have gone differently. You know, maybe if they'd walked in and he was, you know, sitting up in his right mind, you know, sword girded on his side, you know, the bow and arrow ready to go, saying, what are you guys doing here? Oh, we just came for some wheat. Okay, well, get your wheat and get going. You know, but it was a lack of vigilance on his part. He's being lazy. He's sleeping, hiding from his problems, hoping it just goes away. It came right to where he was, and killed him. You know, and being vigilant is something that we have to take seriously, you know, because it's becoming increasingly more important as this world grows more wicked and more wicked and more wicked. You know, it's not going to get better. It's going to get worse. You know, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. You know, that's the way it's going to go. You know, perilous times shall come, the Bible says. It's not like all of a sudden, you know, we get the right guy in the White House. You know, we get enough of the, you know, enough Republicans in the Senate or whatever, and we get the right laws passed, and everything's going to shift, and then we're going to turn back into a godly nation. You know, it's too far gone. I don't want to go on and on about that. But, you know, the fact is, you know, things are going to get worse. I mean, haven't they been getting worse? I mean, I don't know that I really have to try to convince people of that. You know, and it's just insane, the things that are going on. It just keeps getting worse and worse. I keep seeing more and more freaks. Everywhere I go, I see more, you know, transvestites hanging around in restaurants and serving food, just out in the open. You know, that wasn't always that way. You know, and it definitely wasn't, oh, you know, let's pay for their operations and help them, you know, transition. You know, it's gotten crazy, folks. You know, and by the way, you know, they're not going to tell you that on the news. They're not going to tell you that on the cable network. You know, the only place you're going to hear it these days is the man of God. And that's, you know, if he's doing his job. And that's why it's important to be in church, because sometimes we need to be woken up. Say, hey, be vigilant. Wake up. It's going to get worse. It's not going to get better. It's going to get worse. I mean, good night. I go up to the, you know, what is that, Florence Boulevard up there? When they got where we pulled off. You know, I used to, when I go back to Phoenix, I would stop there at In-N-Out until I saw some dude serving me my food with mascara and lipstick. I said, well, I'm not going to that one. You know, so that, you know, we're going up there to go to the mountain. I'm like, well, let's go to Cane's. You know, there's some freak in there, some dude in short shorts, long hair, mascara, earrings. You know, I didn't want to draw everybody else's attention to it when we were getting there because I didn't want to ruin everybody else's appetite. But now I think about it, I think, you know, what I should have done is just told him, you know what, cancel my order. I don't want to order from this place where you have some freak behind the counter. But I mean, it's like there's a freak across the street. There's one here. It's like they're everywhere. And all I'm trying to make is, the point I'm trying to make is this, is that it's going to get worse and worse. It's going to be Pride Month, then it's going to be Pride Months, then it's going to be Pride Year, and it's just going to be Pride all the time. It's going to be in our face all the time. It's getting worse, folks. That's why it's important that we do what? Be vigilant. Be vigilant people. You know, be on the lookout, especially as leaders in our homes and in our churches. You know, we need to be people who are vigilant and call this stuff out and guide our families. This is what made, you know, this is what made Ish-bosheth such a weak leader. His lack of vigilance, his laziness, his fear of man. You know, his dependency on Abner is another big one. Go to Galatians 6, Galatians chapter 6. We'll come back to 2 Samuel in a minute, but go to Galatians chapter 6. You know, we don't want to be overly dependent on other people. We should definitely be willing to, you know, there's a time when we, and to a certain degree, we should always be able to lean on other people for help. But, you know, there needs to come a time when we as leaders stand on our own two feet, you know. And that's something I'm always reminding myself of, you know, because of the position that we're in as a church, you know, and myself as you know, the position that I'm in. You know, we've kind of got a handrail down here right now, don't we? You know, enough comes in that the rent gets paid, but you know what? A lot of what the finances are taken care of by, you know, Faithful Word Tempe, and praise God for that. You know, I'm not saying that's a bad thing. But I'm saying this is that we can't as a church, you know, and I can't as a leader become complacent with that. We should always be mindful of the fact that, you know, we need to become an independent church eventually. And in God's timing, it'll grow and everything like that. But we don't want to become overly dependent on other people to where, you know, we can never stand on our own two feet. You know, it's like that baby. Of course, you know, the baby, a newborn, you don't just immediately ask it to start walking. You know, you don't put shoes on it and demand it, you know, to drive down to the grocery store and get you some whatever. Go buy a jug of milk. You know, you have to grow into that position, right? You have to develop that independence. And that was part of Ish-bosheth's problem, I believe, is that because he was installed by Abner, he kind of just learned to lean on Abner the whole time. You know, and then once Abner was gone, it was like, whoa, whoops. He never learned to stand on his own, right? Look at Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens. So should we be able to bear one another's burdens? Should we be able to put burdens on other people and help expect other brothers and sisters in the church and other people to help us with our burdens? Yeah. But it shouldn't be like, well, just bear all my burdens all the time, right? Because he says, bear ye one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if a man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth himself. But let every man prove his own work, then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone and not another. For every man shall bear his own burden. So yeah, we do want to be able to bear one another's burdens. But at some point, you know, we need to be able to bear our own burdens as well. We need to be able to what? To prove our own work. And that's, you know, I think part of what made Ish-bosheth such a weak leader is that he was overly dependent. There was no ambition. There was no desire to be his own man, to be, you know, separate from Abner. You know, he was always relying on the power of Abner, relying on his influence. You know, there needs to be a time, you know, where, and you know, we could talk about that as a church, but, you know, we could also talk about that, you know, as individuals, you know, within this church. You know, I'm of course here to help people. I'm here to answer questions. I'm here to, you know, guide people along. But I'm not one of these people that wants to carry people, because this is my experience when it comes with carrying people. I mean, I'm all for lifting somebody up, dusting them off, helping them and getting them back on the right track, and you know, encouraging them along. But this is not me. I'm not going to come pick you up and go, oh, how far can we go like this? Because that's going to wear me down. And here's the thing. As soon as I get so worn out from trying to carry, and this goes for everybody. You know, if you're the type of person who's just going to carry everybody or carry anybody, really, you know, this could happen to you where you just get so worn out that you can't go further anymore. And then once you put that person down, you know what happens? They stay right where they are, or the worst, they go back to where they were. Because that person needs to learn how to stand on their own two feet, learn how to have their own walk with Christ, learn how to, you know, read their Bible for themselves, answer their questions, and move along through the Christian life and progress. We don't want to be like Ish-bosheth, where we're just always leaning on somebody who's more experienced, more, you know, of course there's a time for that. We do bear one another's burdens, but look, we need to make sure that that's not become a crutch for us. You know, we should always desire to be able to stand on our own two feet, because that, you know, that's what happens when you're always relying on something else, when you're not the one that's doing the work. You know, when you get bedridden, you know, your muscles atrophy, and then you have to learn how to walk again. You have to develop everything. You know, we don't want to be people that are carried through life or pushed through life and, you know, escorted. We want to be able to stand on our own two feet. You know, and you can apply that to parenthood. You know, parents should begin to let their children stand on their own two feet. You know, obviously there needs to be limits and barriers to keep everybody safe. But you know what? As children get older, they need to be given more responsibility, take things on. Why? So they can see what the world is really like and begin to understand what it is to take on responsibility and grow into an adulthood so they can be strong adults, right? We don't want to be the type of parent that just carries our kid through life and just does every little thing for them. We want to be people who, you know, push them to stand on their own two feet. Because if we don't, we're going to be like Ish-bosheth, a weak leader, somebody who didn't stand on his own, who couldn't stand up for himself, who did not, what, prove his own work. That's a great thing about when you start to stand on your own two feet, when you're not leaning on somebody all the time, is that it says, every man shall prove his own work, then what? And then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone. You know, there's a sense of accomplishment that comes along with that, isn't there? You know, we got to the saddle, me and Rafa. I know he's not here, so I'll pick on him a little bit. You know, but we got there. But you know what? I didn't carry him up that mountain. You know, we helped each other get up there, but there was no carrying going on. And here's the thing: when we got there, there was a sense of accomplishment. You know, we had rejoicing in ourselves alone. Yeah, we kind of helped each other, right? We encouraged one another. But when we got there, you know, there's a sense of having accomplished something, right? I told you I'm just gonna milk that thing for so many illustrations. You're gonna get sick of it. But that's what he's saying here. Look, every man shall prove his own work. We're gonna stand on our own. Why? Because then we can have rejoicing in ourselves alone and not another. Leaders have to learn to stand on their own two feet. So these, you know, I'm gonna move along. I know I'm kind of running out of time here, but you know, I'm looking at the negative aspects of Ish-bosheth. You know, the negative qualities of a leader that we need to be on guard against in our lives. But David, you know, is somebody who we can look to and see some, you know, I'm not going to focus on everything about David, obviously, but there are a few attributes about David that we see in this chapter that we as leaders do need to keep in mind. You know, and it kind of counters it here because, you know, I'm talking about being vigilant, standing on your own, you know, being a go-getter, you know, being assertive, that kind of a thing, but we don't want to be overbearing. You know, as leaders too. Leaders have to balance, you know, being when to be strong and firm, and also when to be soft and gentle, right? When to come down hard and when to what? Be merciful, right? So David, you know, was kind of the opposite of some of these negative attributes. And, you know, he was kind of, and it seems like in the story, people haven't figured out what David's like yet. But David was a very merciful person. You know, one thing about David is that he's, you know, his life is just, you keep seeing mercy over and over again. I'm not saying he's perfect. And look, by the time we get to the end of 2 Samuel, we're gonna see some major flaws with David. I mean, he was, you know, but that's what I love about the Bible. It has flawed characters because that makes it relatable because we're all flawed, right? But David was a very merciful person. You know, we went through 1 Samuel already. We talked about all the mercy he showed Saul. And if you look there in verse 4 of 2 Samuel chapter 4, it says, "And Jonathan, Saul's son, had a son that was lame of his feet, He was 5 years old when the tidings of Saul and Jonathan came out of Jezreel, and his nurse took him up and fled. And it came to pass, as she made haste to flee, that he fell and became lame, and his name was Mephibosheth. So you see here that, you know, you think when you read this story, it says, well, maybe David wasn't that great of a guy. Maybe he wasn't. What do you mean he's merciful? I mean, look, she's fleeing. But you know what? She had no reason to flee. It's because she didn't know what David was like. And sometimes people can get this idea about leaders. They can think that leader, you know, they're always just this hard-nosed guy or whatever. You know, they can say, oh, dad's always just such a hard case. You know, the preacher's always such a hard case. You know, they're such, you know, just rough individuals. You know, they might be hesitant to go to that person and ask for help. They have this, you know, a misunderstanding of what that person is like, okay? Jonathan's very merciful, but this nurse, you know, she just takes up Mephibosheth and just starts running. As soon as she hears that Jonathan and Saul are dead, she just takes off because she's like, oh, great, David's going to come in and just clean house. Well, you must not know David very well because David's a very merciful man. And unfortunately, you know, Mephibosheth is made lame because of it, right? But here's the thing. You say, well, how do you know he's merciful? Well, go to 2 Samuel chapter 21. I'll speed up for sake of time here. Go to 2 Samuel chapter 21. If you remember, David had made an oath to Jonathan right before they parted ways, right before he had to flee from Saul into the wilderness. They had made an oath. And I'll read to you. It says, and Jonathan said in 1 Samuel 20, and thou shalt not only while I yet live show me this kindness of the Lord that I die not. So Jonathan's saying, hey, I know you're going to get the throne. Please don't kill me, right? Show me mercy. But also thou shalt not cut off thy kindness from my house forever. He's not talking about his physical house, right? He's talking about his people, his family. No, not when the Lord hath cut off these enemies of the enemies of David, every one from the face of the earth. He's talking about his own dad there. He gets it. You know, that's what made the death of Jonathan so tragic, is that he's a guy who saw things for what they were. He was willing to admit, you know, David was next in the throne. He went with the will of God. But he said, look, when they cut off the enemies of the house of David, everyone from the face of the earth, you know, be kind to my house forever. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, let the Lord even require it at the hand of David's enemies. And Jonathan caused David to swear again because he loved him, for he loved him as his own soul. So Jonathan and David had made this pact before this whole thing even took place with him having to flee from Saul, that he would what? Preserve Jonathan, that when he came into the throne, that he would not take out Jonathan nor his house, his seed, you know, his children after him. And here's the thing about David, you know, he was a man of his word, you know, which is another attribute for a leader. You know, if we want people to trust us and follow us and people to, you know, have confidence in us, you know, we need to follow through with what we say. Now, we might not always be perfect in that area, but we should definitely strive to be, you know. David followed through. Here's 2 Samuel 21, verse 6. He said, let seven men of his sons be delivered unto us, and we will hang up unto the Lord in Gibeah of Saul, whom the Lord did choose. And the king said, I will give them. So, if you remember the story, basically, for sake of time, seven of Saul's sons had to die, had to be killed, because of God was punishing them. And he said, look, I'll give them, okay? But the king, verse 7, spared Mephibosheth, right, who we just read about in chapter 4, right, who was made lame. The son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, because the Lord's oath was between them, between David and Jonathan, the son of Saul. So David is a very merciful man. You know, he'd already made this pact, and this nurse, you know, she hears that Saul and David, or Saul and Jonathan are dead, and she just instantly assumes the worst, just grabs the kid and starts running, and you know, a tragedy takes place because of it. And there was no reason to flee. I mean, have you noticed that so far in these first few chapters, is that David is patiently waiting for the throne to come to him? He's not forcing the issue. That God has told him that he is going to be the king. You know, he knew that all the way back when he was fleeing from Saul. But he's sitting here and he's waiting for the throne to come to him. I mean, he's got Ish-bosheth right where he wants him. I mean, Abner's dead. All Israel's troubled. He could have gone in there. I mean, it might have led to civil war, but he's got all the mighty men on his side. He's been whooping the house of Saul, you know, already. He's already been beating the Benjamites. He could go in there and just take over. But what does he do? He's waiting because he's merciful. Because he didn't want to just go shed a bunch of innocent blood. He didn't want to just, you know, have all this warfare. He's a very merciful man. But that doesn't make him a weak leader, does it? To be merciful, okay? And really, I love this picture, and I don't have really time to develop it. It's really a whole sermon in and of itself. But David's mercy to Mephibosheth, right? It's kind of because David in the Old Testament is a picture of Jesus Christ. You know, it's not a perfect picture. No picture is. They all fall apart at some point because we're talking about sinful men here. But he is a picture of Christ, and we can see certain stories and certain attributes in him that picture the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you think about this mercy that he shows to Mephibosheth, you know, that's a picture of God's mercy toward us. You know, we are fallen, right? We're broken. We're lame, right? And the king, you know, shows mercy towards us. He makes a covenant with us. You know, even and he's made that covenant even what? Before we were born. You know, David made that covenant with Jonathan before Mephibosheth was even in the picture. You know, he's 5 years old when this happened, when the tidings of Saul comes. You know, back then, you know, many years later, he didn't even exist. Same way with us. You know, God, you know, before the world was made, has ordained eternal life for us, has made a way of salvation. He was the lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world to show us mercy. So this is a great picture of Jesus Christ here. You know, we've been laid by lame by sin. We're weak before a mighty God, before a mighty king, and we've been shown mercy through that promise that was made before we were born. And you know what? Just like David was kept his word, we can be sure that God's going to keep his word. You know, that he's going to keep us. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. That, you know, that no man is going to be able to pluck us out of his hand. That we have passed from death unto life with the Lord. So that's a great picture there. That's a whole sermon right there. So David was, you know, and these are just a few of his attributes that we're looking at. Mainly we're looking at Ishbosheth, right? Well, we don't want to be fearful, lazy, hiding, not vigilant, so on and so forth. You know, over-dependent on other people, not being able to stand on our own two feet. You know, leaders have to be people that are go-getters. They have to take initiative. You know, they have to lead the charge, right? Those are things we don't want to be like, okay? And we're looking at, you know, one thing about David is that as leaders, we have to remember to be merciful people and not just come down on people for every offense. David was a great leader because he was not only merciful, but also because of the fact that he was just. See, and that's the thing. Sometimes people start to confuse meekness with weakness, right? They start to see how merciful somebody is, and they think, oh, he's a weak leader, you know, because he didn't come down. Well, no, it's just that wasn't the appropriate reaction, right? That don't forget that what goes on in the story. David still gets some people pretty good, right? There's still some hands and some feet get cut off, you know. He's still just. He's merciful but just. It's such a great picture of Christ. Very merciful but also just, right? You're there. And did I have you go to 2 Samuel? Look at chapter 23. Go to 2 Samuel. We've been in 2 Samuel. What am I saying? Go to chapter 23. Very quickly, verse 3, I'll begin reading. These are the last words of David, right? He said, "The God of Israel said, the Rock of Israel spake to me, he that ruleth over men must be just, ruling in the fear of God." So not only was David a very merciful person, but he was a very just person as well. Go back to 2 Samuel chapter 4. You know, if we're going to rule, if we're going to be leaders, we have to make sure that we rule, you know, not only with mercy, but also being just in the fear of God. Being, you know, I talked about this, you know, on Sunday, you know, being what? Impartial in judgment. You know, not doing nothing by partiality, okay? Not preferring one above another. He said in verse 8 there of 2 Samuel chapter 4, we'll see David's justice here. He says, "And they brought the head of Ishbosheth, the sons of Rimmon," right? They cut off his head. "And they brought the head of Ishbosheth unto David." What a nice gift, you know? By the way, if you're ever Christmas shopping for me, that's not what I'm looking for. A bloody head, all right? "But that's what they bring to David to Hebron, and said to the king, behold, the head of Ishbosheth, the son of Saul, thine enemy." So they think that they're, you know, doing David a service here. And really what they're showing is how disloyal they are. Because remember, these are the captains of Ishbosheth. Look, if I'm a leader and you cut this guy's head off and you come to me, I'm just going to say, well, I'm next. Next time I'm, you know, you catch me off guard, maybe I'm next. Maybe you think there's somebody else that would be impressed with my head. You know, that's the thing about disloyalty, is that it's kind of a mark on your character. You know, I mean, David, he's like, oh, thanks, you know. Yeah, bloody head. No, that's not what he does. Verse 9, "And David answered Rechab and Baanah, his brother, the sons of Rimmon the Beerothite, and said unto them, as the Lord liveth, who hath redeemed my soul out of all adversity, when one told me, saying, behold, Saul is dead, thinking to have brought good tidings." Of course, he's talking about the Amalekite, right, that we read about earlier. when he came to him and said, hey, I'm the one that slew him. Here's his bracelet. Here's his crown. He says, when he brought good tidings, I took hold of him and slew him in Ziklag, who thought I would have given him a reward for his tidings. How much more when wicked men have slain a righteous person in his own house upon his bed? I mean, he just sees these guys for exactly, he calls them wicked. They're showing up with this bloody head thinking, man, we're going to get a reward. We're going to be made captains in his army. We're going to get, who knows what. But instead, you know, David, not only being a merciful man, but a just man, calls them out for what they are. You know, sometimes there's a time where you just got to call things like they are and just say it like it is. And that's what he did here. He said, look, you guys are wicked because you killed a righteous man. That's what he thought of Ish-bosheth. He said, this is a righteous man. Okay. And he said, how much, I killed this guy when he brought me tidings about Saul. How much more am I going to do it? Because Saul was his enemy, right? Ish-bosheth, was he David's enemy? I mean, we don't see him going after David. He says, look, how much more because when you wicked guys have slain this righteous person in his own house upon his own bed, like a couple of cowards. Shall I not therefore now require his blood of your hand and take away you from the earth? And David commanded his young men, and they slew them and cut off their hands and their feet and hanged them over in the pool of Hebron. But they took the head of Ish-bosheth and buried it in the sepulcher of Abner in Hebron. So not only did they get killed, they also got, humiliated, a very shameful death. And then they weren't even properly buried. You know, their bodies are desecrated and hung out for everybody to see as what? As an example, right? To say, look, this is what happens. This is what David thinks about people who just, kill innocent people, who are just trying, self-serving, who are just trying to advance, literally on the heads of other people, right? And who are just trying to use other people as a stepping stone, who are willing to just cut throats to get ahead. This is what he thinks of them, right? Because he doesn't want this to happen again. He's a just man, okay? David's very just. Not only is he merciful, right? He's showing, and what is mercy? Not getting what you deserve. Maybe it would be the right thing to come down hard. He doesn't do it, right? But there's a time and place to also be just. So David, he avenges this innocent blood of Ish-bosheth, and he holds these wicked people accountable. And, this doesn't make him a tyrant, by the way. And, I'm just going to close on this point because it needs to be said, but we're living in this country where people think that anytime, our government uses any kind of force these days, it's that they're somehow tyrants. I wrote this, and then I was kind of thinking, what is an example? Well, what is a modern-day example of people taking, of looking at somebody that's there to serve justice and then trying to make them into a tyrant? And I thought, the Portland Police Department. I mean, here's this police department, and I get it, we have these different beliefs about police, should they or not, or do or not, should they or should they exist, look, they're there, okay? And there's good people that are policemen, not every cop's a bad cop, and it's not a job I would want, but, I'm glad there's somebody there that wants to do that, I guess, but here's the thing, when you have a city like Portland that's just been tearing itself apart, like, I don't know, has anybody seen what's going on up there? Just riots. Nonstop. You think those riots ended? They've been going on this whole time. They go on. Pastor Aaron Thompson, works up there, and he, lives in Vancouver right across the river, and you could talk to him about it when he's here. They're rioting all the time. They're down, they go down to the Capitol building there and set it on fire. They're storming the mayor's house, demanding him to come outside. He's dumb enough to go out there, and they start getting after him. They bring him back inside. But they've told the cops to stand down. They can't do anything. They just have to sit there and watch the shops get smashed and burned. They just have to watch these guys just tear it apart. And then, the entire riot team up there just retired. They just all, like a week or two ago, just all said, we quit. And they all quit. And they're trying to defund them, and say, hey, they shouldn't have any, take away their money, take away their power. And we can debate about whether or not cops should or shouldn't exist. But here's the thing. I'm using this as an illustration to show you that sometimes people look at leadership that's doling out justice, that's there to execute righteousness, and they say, oh, that's a tyrant. They hear some preacher get up and preach God's word and say it like it is, and they say, oh, he's just a bully. He's a he's misogynistic. He's just mean or whatever. Or is it this that he's just, or he's just saying what the word says? They see some person like David, you know, is actually executing righteousness, and they say, oh, that's just brutality. You know, think about, okay, here's another example, the death penalty. And the Bible says that, you know, if a man sheds another man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. You know, that the Bible demands the death penalty for certain sins, like murder, adultery, rape, these other and other things. You know, not stealing, you know. And it doesn't prescribe locking people in a cage either. But, you know, people would look at that and say, oh, the death penalty, how barbaric. You know, how wicked, or, you know, that's terrible. That guy's a tyrant. You know, it's so Stone Age. The Bible says it's righteous. Amen. The Bible says the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we don't want to get this idea about when we see righteous leadership, when we see people take a hard stand, we see people dole out justice and get this, you know, soft attitude or this, you know, start feeling bad for, you know, the sons of Rimmon of this world, you know, and get a soft spot. And I was going to go to Romans 13 and look at that, but I won't. We just need to understand that, you know, the truly unloving people in this world, the ones that let evil go unpunished. That let evil go unpunished. They're the ones that are unloving, the ones that don't execute righteousness and judgment. You know, and that's what's going on in our country. You know, the abortions, the sodomy, the adultery, the murder. I mean, it's just the atrocities that are taking place in our country where people are just getting a little slap on the wrist. You know, some pedophile is just getting a few years in prison. That guy should be dead. Amen. You know, and a lot of other people. And I know I'm going on, but on and on, but we don't want to, you know, it's worth pointing out, you know, that if we're going to be strong leaders, you know, we need to be merciful people, but we also need to understand that we have to be just, you know, and when we see other leadership, when we see people doling out justice and making decisions and maybe hard ones, and people are suffering as a result, we need to understand that that's the right thing, you know, and we should support that leadership. Let's go ahead and pray.